Good morning, everybody. How are you today? I am so blessed to be here today to see you. I know I say that every time, but I really look forward to this. This is kind of my favorite thing about my week is coming and preaching and talking to you, because it's almost as if I don't get to see everybody else. I don't get to see everybody except for now, but I'm not really seeing you, but I am talking to you. So hello. God bless you guys. Good to see you. Before we get started into our preaching, I wanted to let you know, we received an email from our conference. Our church is a part of a conference of churches, and the conference sent us an email and let us know that we are being advised to not meet until May. And that's if everything else goes well. And so we are going to continue doing this through April. And I know that that means Easter and Good Friday. We're going to think about how we can make that special for our Lord. I'm not exactly how or if we can, but I know that God is good. And he will provide the things that he desires for us to do. And so I'm very blessed by that. When I first rolled up here, I saw our cherry trees. Our cherry trees are in blossom right now, and it is so beautiful. And I took a picture and put it on our Facebook page and sent everybody an email. And you look at the beautiful blossoming of this cherry tree, and it's so gorgeous. And then you look up and you see the ominous sky, this dark sky threatening storm. And it just kind of reminded me that in Christ, we are like that tree. We are blooming. We are blessed, regardless of what's going on outside, regardless of the storm to come. We are who we are because of what Christ has done. Amen. And because of what Christ has done, we can rejoice and we can be thankful for him. And we don't have to freak out about this time. So let me lead us in prayer before we get started into the preaching. Good morning, Lord. It's such an honor to be able to speak with you. I can't believe we actually have that opportunity. I love that we can always speak to you on the way to work, even if it's in our bedroom during the day, at night. I mean, the curtain has been torn, and we can go directly to you. So we love you and we thank you. Father, as I preach, I pray that your words would come through this sermon. I don't want to have any part of this. I want you to take me over, so that your will can be done on earth as it is in heaven. We love you desperately. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Well, we are in a series on suffering that was started providentially because God had us start going through it before the coronavirus stuff hit. And so we've been talking about suffering, and we've been talking about Joseph. We've been talking about this poor kid who was sold into slavery by his brothers because they were jealous of him. They didn't like the favoritism that his dad showed them. And so this poor kid gets sold into slavery, and he ends up in Egypt. And in Egypt, he gets put into this house of this guy named Potiphar, who's way high up in Pharaoh's kingdom. And he's doing great there because the Lord is with him. That's crazy. The Lord is with this nobody slave from a foreign land in Egypt. And it's so cool because the Lord is with him, and God not only blessed Joseph, but blessed Potiphar and everybody there. And so a turn for the worse happens. Joseph's boss's wife starts hitting on him and wants to take him to bed. And Joseph's like, no. And so she makes this a story about Joseph trying to rape her, and she got away barely. And so she tells her husband, and Potiphar throws Joseph in jail. And the suffering that Joseph had to go through now in this new season was terrible, I would imagine. And yet it says the Lord was with him. The Lord was with him in the suffering. The Lord didn't remove him from his suffering. The Lord was with him in his suffering, because his suffering had a purpose. And so he's in jail. The Lord is with him, and the Lord is blessing him and the warden. And the warden puts Joseph in charge of everything in the jail, just like Potiphar did at everything in Potiphar's house. And so Joseph is in charge, and two of Pharaoh's like high up employees, he's upset with them and throws them in jail, and they end up with Joseph. And Joseph, even though he's in suffering, sees them suffering and asks. I love that. He wasn't so self-consumed by his suffering that he only cared about himself. He asked, what's going on? And they said they had these dreams and they didn't know what they meant, and they were depressed. They didn't know what to do about it. And so Joseph interprets their dreams because God is with them. And another way of saying it is God interprets their dreams and the dreams come true. The two of them go and they get reinstalled. Well, they get brought back to Pharaoh's house in 3 days, as Joseph predicted. And one of them gets reinstalled and the other one gets impaled. Yay! And so it was just so funny. These God's will, right, is just so hard sometimes to deal with for some, but amazing for others. And so one of the things that Joseph says is he tells the cupbearer, who is like the person who protects the food of Pharaoh and protects Pharaoh's life through the food, Joseph tells the cupbearer, hey, you're going to get reinstalled. When you get reinstalled, remember me. Don't forget me. Remember me, because I was sold by my brothers into slavery, and I'm now here in jail. I didn't even do anything wrong. Remember me. So Joseph, even in his suffering, didn't pretend he wasn't suffering. He just allowed the Lord to redeem it. And so that leads us to where we're at right now. This is Genesis chapter 41, verse 1. So if you want to pause this and go grab your Bible, we're going to be reading a lot of scripture today, which is a good thing. We're commanded in the pastoral epistles to devote ourselves daily to the public reading of scripture. So that's kind of what I'm doing right now, is we're going to read God's word. Okay. So Genesis 41, verse 1, it says, when two full years had passed, Joseph had been forgotten for 2 years. That's rough. 2 years, Pharaoh had a dream. So Pharaoh's the king of Egypt. Egypt is the world power of the time. He's probably the most influential and powerful man on earth, okay, at that time, or at least in the known world for them. Pharaoh had a dream. He was standing by the Nile, that's the giant river that feeds Egypt, when out of the river, there came up 7 cows, sleek and fat, and they grazed among the reeds. After them, 7 other cows, ugly and gaunt, came up out of the Nile and stood beside those on the riverbank. And the cows that were ugly and gaunt ate up the 7 sleek, fat cows. And then Pharaoh woke up. Crazy dream. And he fell asleep again. Verse 5, he fell asleep again, and he had a second dream. 7 heads of grain, healthy and good, were growing on a single stalk. After them, 7 other heads of grain sprouted, thin and scorched by the east wind. The thin heads of grain swallowed up the 7 healthy full heads. And then Pharaoh woke up. It had been another dream. So Pharaoh has this dream. Now, dreams are all over Joseph's life, right? Dreams are a way that God sometimes talks to us. Not all the time. Sometimes we just have anxiety dreams. Sometimes we don't even know why we have dreams, but these were dreams that God was giving them. Okay, these were God-provided dreams. And so Pharaoh has this dream. And verse 8, in the morning, his mind was troubled. That's Pharaoh. So he sent for all the magicians and the wise men of Egypt. Pharaoh told them his dreams, but no one could interpret them for him. So the wise men of Egypt, his counselors, his cabinet, his pastors, his magicians, I mean, all of the wise men of Egypt come and they can't interpret it. These are the guys that are supposed to be able to interpret it. The reason that they couldn't interpret it was because they weren't from God. In other words, God was not with them. They didn't have the truth from God because God was not with them. And Pharaoh so desperately needed this truth. So desperately needed this truth. It reminded me as I was thinking through this and praying through this, how desperate people are for truth right now. Truth about the future. Truth about this virus. Truth about suffering. Truth about religion. Truth about sacred. Truth about the afterlife. Truth about sexuality and purpose and relationships. Everybody's asking questions, and the only people who have the truth are the people who the Lord is with, through Christ. Because without revelation from God, we cannot know the truth. So there's Pharaoh. He's upset. He's freaked out. He has these dreams. He doesn't know what to do with them. And then in verse 9, it says, the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, remember him? He was reinstalled. Today I am reminded of my shortcomings. Pharaoh was once angry with his servants, and he imprisoned me and the chief baker in the house of the captain of the guard. Each of us had a dream the same night, and each dream had its own meaning. Now a young Hebrew was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. We told him our dreams, and he interpreted them for us, giving each man the interpretation of his dream. And these things turned out exactly as he interpreted them to us. I was restored to my position, and the other man was impaled. You see, it was at this time that God allowed Pharaoh to have a dream and not have the interpretation of the dream. And the cupbearer just so happens providentially to be walking by and then remember Joseph. So he told Pharaoh about Joseph. This is not a coincidence. You start to try to see the providential hand of God working here. Verse 14. So Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought from the dungeon. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before Pharaoh. That was because the Israelites had beards and robes, and the Egyptians dressed very different. But specifically, Joseph was in a dungeon, and he looked a mess, and so Pharaoh cleaned him up. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream, and no one can interpret it. But I have heard it said to you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. Very interesting. I love what Joseph says here, verse 16. I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he deserves. Again, Joseph says, just like he said to the cupbearer and the warden and the Potiphar and the baker, this is about God. It's because the Lord is with me. He gives God the credit. You see, he couldn't do it on his own. He couldn't interpret the dream any more than Peter could walk on water, any more than Moses could part the Red Sea. He needed God. Verse 17, then Pharaoh said to Joseph, in my dream, and then he tells him the dream about the cows and the grains, this bizarre dream. Okay? Verse 25. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, "The dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do." So God is talking to Pharaoh through Joseph, through this dream. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he's about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years, and the seven heads of grain are 7 years. It is one and the same dream. The seven lean, ugly cows that came up afterwards are 7 years, and the seven worthless heads of grain scorched by the east wind, they are 7 years of famine. It is just as I said to Pharaoh, God has shown Pharaoh what he's about to do. 7 years of great abundance are coming throughout the land of Egypt, but 7 years of famine will follow. Then all the abundance in Egypt will be forgotten, and the famine will ravage the land. The abundance in the land will not be remembered because the famine that follows will be so severe. The reason my dream was given to Pharaoh in two forms is that the matter has been firmly decided by God, and God will do it soon. So Joseph interprets this dream, and now God gives Joseph a plan of action on what to do about it. Verse 33, "And now let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all the food of these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. The food should be held in reserve for the country to be used during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt so that the country may not be ruined by the famine." So what we see here is God gave Pharaoh a dream that only Joseph can interpret to tell him how to be saved. There was a coming famine, there was coming abundance, and then a coming famine, and they were all going to die if they did not follow God's plan of salvation through the revelation that he gave Joseph. In verse 38, "So Pharaoh asked them, 'Can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God?'" I love that. I love the fact that Pharaoh saw the best thing about Joseph was the Spirit of God. It wasn't, "Can we find any man who's as awesome as Joseph? Can we find any man who is as good looking as Joseph?" It's, "Can we find any man who is full of the Spirit of God like Joseph?" The best thing about Joseph was God. I've said that 1,000 times about our church, right? The best thing about our church should never be anything other than God, anything other than Jesus, right? If the best thing about our church is something lesser, then we're in trouble. It's got to be God. Let's see, verse 39. "Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'Since God has made all this known to you, there is no one so discerning and wise. You shall be in charge of my palace, and all my people are submit to your orders.'" Whoa. Joseph, slave, prisoner, convict, now in charge of Pharaoh's palace. "Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you." So Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his finger and put it on Joseph's finger. Signet ring was like a way of a signature. You know, if Joseph could sign for stuff, you know, it was like, "Thus saith Pharaoh," because Joseph had the signet ring, and he would put a, it was like a stamp, okay? And only people who worked for Pharaoh in the highest level had this ring. And Pharaoh took his signet ring from his finger and put it on Joseph's finger. You know what he did next? Listen to this, verse 42. He dressed him in robes of fine linen. Oh man, Joseph had his robe taken from him. Now he gets one even better. Fine linen, and puts a gold chain around his neck. He had him ride in a chariot as his second in command. And people shouted before him, "Make way!" Thus he put him in charge of the whole land of Egypt. And then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, but without you, without your word, no one will lift hand or foot in all of Egypt." So you go from the youngest brother, the spoiled brother, the hated brother, the brother put in the cistern, left to death, taken out of the cistern because we might as well make some money off of him instead of just letting him die. His brothers sell him into slavery. He goes into slavery, gets sold to Potiphar's house, does great, gets lied about, gets thrown into jail, does great, gets forgotten, now gets put into the number two position in all of Egypt. Why? Because the Lord was with him. That's why. His success didn't have as much to do with him as it did with God. Joseph had to be obedient to what God was having him do. Obedience was necessary, but it was God's hand that was enabling him to be obedient and giving him the wisdom to do all the things that God had called him to do. Verse 46, Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. 30 years old. Is there anybody else who was 30 years old when they entered public ministry? We'll talk about that later. And Joseph went out from Pharaoh's presence and traveled throughout Egypt. And during the 7 years of abundance, the land produced plentifully. Joseph collected all the food produced in those 7 years of abundance in Egypt and stored it in the cities. In each city, he put the food grown in the fields surrounding it. Joseph stored up huge quantities of grain like the sands of the sea. It was so much that he stopped keeping records because it was done. Look, Joseph did what God called him to do, what God told him to do, what he had been appointed to do. Joseph was obedience. And it was through Joseph's obedience to God's revealed plan on how to save the world that the world, the known world at the time, was saved. Verse 53, the 7 years of abundance in Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began. Joseph, just as Joseph had said, it was true. There was famine in all the other lands, but in the whole land of Egypt there was food. When all Egypt began to feel the famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for food. Oh, this is so good. The people cried to Pharaoh for food. Then Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, "Go to Joseph and do what he tells you." And all the world, that's all the known world at the time, came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe everywhere. Listen, they cried to Pharaoh. Pharaoh sent them to Joseph because Joseph had provided them with the plan of salvation for the whole world. And they were saved. When they went to Joseph, they received the food that they so desperately needed. This is incredible. Do you see the shadow of Christ? Keep your spiritual eyes open as we go here. People needed to be saved from the famine, so they went to the only place they could find the salvation, the food, and that was God in Joseph in Egypt. They knew they needed to be saved. They knew there was a problem. They knew they needed to be saved. And they knew the only one who could save them was God in Joseph in Egypt. I think about this, knowing that you need to be saved and going to the only place where you can find it. And it reminds me of Peter. Thousands of years later, Jesus is on earth and he's preaching, and he's preaching hard things. And these hard things that he's preaching, these hard things are about the bread of life. If you eat of my body, you will be saved. People were freaked out by it. Even some of his disciples, even those were following him. They're like, well, do you want us to be cannibals? I mean, this is weird, right? And so they bolted, they left. The teaching was too hard about being saved through eating the bread of life. So Jesus watches them go and he turns to his 12 disciples and he says, you do not want to leave too, do you? Jesus asked the 12, I love what Peter said. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Isn't that incredible? Wow. So the people need to be saved and they go to Egypt and Pharaoh sends them to Joseph, who was full of God. The Spirit of God is in him and he is saved and he gives them salvation. Verse 56. When the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout the world. The good news about how to be saved was revealed to the whole world through Joseph. Joseph had been given the plan of salvation and done what it did, what it took to save the world. Now we see why he suffered. Now we see why he had to go through these things. God's plan was to save Egypt and the whole world from this famine through Joseph. Joseph had to get there somehow. So he got there through the cistern, through Potiphar's house, through the jail, growing his gifts, growing his talents, possibly growing his faith. We don't know, but these 13 years of slavery and betrayal and suffering had a purpose. The purpose of this suffering was to save the world. God, through his providence, moved Joseph from the cistern to the house to the dungeon to the palace. And the Lord was with him the whole time. He was never alone. He was suffering, but he wasn't alone. The Lord was with him the whole time. Potiphar threw him in jail, but God was with him. The cupbearer forgot him. But God did not. He was never tempted beyond what he can bear. He endured the suffering and served in it faithfully. Wow. And through it, God saved the known world. Now, the Old Testament's about Jesus, right? That's what he told the disciples on the road to Emmaus. It said, beginning with Moses and the prophets, he explained everything I had to say about him. This story about Joseph is about Jesus. It's a true story. It's a shadow. Joseph is a type of Jesus. Think about how similar Joseph and your Savior, Jesus, are. This is incredible. Listen to this. Both of them are loved dearly by their fathers. Both were shepherds of their father's sheep. Both were sent by their fathers to their brothers who hated them and conspired against them. Both were sold for the price of a slave. Oh, isn't this incredible? This is incredible. Both were tempted. Jesus in the desert. Joseph in Potiphar's house. Both were put into prison. Both were placed with two other prisoners. This is so good. One who was saved and the other who was lost. Jesus on the cross. The one prisoner on the cross was saved and the other one was lost. Both began their public ministry when they were 30 years old. Oh, and listen to this. Both of them brought salvation to the world. Joseph brought a worldly, earthly, fleshly salvation to the known world. Jesus brought spiritual and eternal salvation to the whole world. Wow. Joseph's suffering is finally redeemed. It is understood as to why he had to go through all of that stuff. And now we see Joseph at peace with his purpose. Now, I jumped over a couple verses that I want to bring you back to. Verse 45, it says, Pharaoh gave Joseph the name Zaphnath-Paneah and gave him Aseneth, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, to be his wife. Okay. Potipharah is not related, in no relations to Potiphar that we know of, but we know that his wife is high up there. And so Joseph marries into a very, very prominently politically based family. Verse 50, before the years of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph by Aseneth, daughter of Potiphar, priest of On. Now, remember this. When they named their kids in the Bible, the number one reason they chose the names was not because it sounded good or it was nice or it was their father's name. Sometimes they did that, but was because it had some kind of great significance in their life. Listen to what Joseph names his kids. 51. Joseph named his firstborn Manasseh. And said, it is because God has made me forget all of my trouble and all of my father's household. Listen, the past was forgotten. The betrayal, the pain, the suffering. The past was forgotten because the present was redeemed. Let me say it again. The past was forgotten because the present was redeemed. When you see how God wants you to be used in your suffering and you allow Him to use you, it helps you go, oh, that's why I'm going through this. Oh, that's why I'm here. I'm not here for nothing. This isn't a coincidence. I don't just have bad luck. God is doing something through me at this time, and it has a purpose, and it's not worthless. God doesn't waste pain. It's on purpose. So Joseph basically says, I'm naming my son Manasseh, which is because God has made me forget all my trouble and my father's house. So it's like, look, I'm done. I'm closing the door on the past because the present has been redeemed. And then the second son, verse 52, he named Ephraim and said, it is because God has made me fruitful in the land of my suffering. God's plan to save the world worked. It was real. Joseph's suffering wasn't about Joseph. It was about saving others. Look, you know, we started this whole series talking about why do we suffer? If God loved us, why would He let us suffer? If God was a good God, why would He let these bad things happen? We talk about suffering in all the different ways that we suffer, through physical sickness, through chemotherapy, through the coronavirus, through emotional pain and energy, through relational conflicts, through disappointment and depression, through isolation, through loneliness, suffering through financial instability, suffering through worry because we don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. Some of us don't even know where our next paycheck is going to come from. For those of us who are in Christ, this suffering has a purpose. The chemo has a purpose. When you go to chemotherapy because you have cancer, you are now exposed to doctors and nurses and other chemo patients that you never would have met before, who desperately need to be saved. They need to hear about Jesus and the hope that you have in Him in your suffering. You can't get there if you don't have chemo. When you think about the difficulties that you have in marriage or with your kids or with your family, and you're like, I just wish everything was fine. I just wish they would change, or I wish I could change, or whatever that is not for nothing. The purpose of that is so that when we finally get some kind of God-given traction in those areas and find some kind of healing, then God will bring people to us who need that same type of healing, that we could say, look, I've been there. I've done that. I know how hard it is. Let me tell you something. If you love your wife or your husband or your kids or your parents more than Jesus, you will have your heart broken over and over again. It is only in Jesus that we can survive these difficult family relations. People need to hear that. And you will lose your testimony if you don't go through that. So you go through it faithfully and obediently like Joseph did. The loneliness has a purpose. You know, I think about all of our friends and people right now who are isolated, who are home by themselves, right? And maybe for introverts, it's awesome. But for others, they're lonely. And if you are in Christ, even if you're not in Christ, God is there. If you are not in Christ, I am telling you right now that God may have you there lonely so that you will finally look to Him to alleviate your suffering, to find your salvation through Christ. If you are in Christ and you are lonely, all you have to do is look to God and say, I'm here. And you can feel Him love you and bless you and say, let's read about my son, or let's pray, talk to me. The financial instability, I have a big feeling that the financial instability that we as a nation, or let's just say the Christians in our nation experiences, is on purpose. I mean, you know what it's going to do? It's going to make us take our hands off of all the stuff that we so desperately love. What did Jesus say about the rich young ruler? The rich young ruler came to Jesus. He was a good, moral, ethical man. And Jesus said, look, you can't follow me because you love money. You love your stuff more than me. That's why you got to sell it and follow me. Everybody doesn't have to sell it, but you do because you love it more than me. It's your idol. I think for me, for us, for those of us in places of affluence, God's going to start taking stuff away from us. We're going to realize that the daily bread is actually better. Because when we have our daily bread, we don't forget about God, or we don't curse God. There is a famine on earth right now. And it's not just the coronavirus. The famine that we have on earth that leads to death is sin. And it's the sin that causes death. God sent Jesus not only to Egypt, but to the whole world. Jesus revealed to us the truth about death and the truth about salvation. This is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And to be saved, we don't need to go to Egypt to buy grain. To be saved, we need to go to Jesus to find eternal life. We don't purchase that food from Joseph to save us because Jesus has already purchased our salvation with his blood. All we need to do is go to him and accept it. Christ, you are the bread of life. We go to Jesus and we eat of the bread and we say, I believe that you are the Savior. I believe that you are the Lord. I believe that you are where I find the salvation that I know I so desperately need. Tell me what to do, Joseph. Tell me what to do, Jesus, so I can live obediently to you in the suffering that I have on earth. And we follow Jesus because of it, my friends. Joseph realized that now that he found his purpose was to bring salvation to the world, that the past didn't matter much anymore. He realized it. The past had been redeemed when he found his purpose. And we find our purpose today too. Look, the suffering that you're going through right now, if you're going through suffering, or the suffering that you're going to be going through through this crazy coronavirus time, has a reason. It has a purpose. And that purpose is to get you to the place of obedience where people can come to you and ask you, why are you faithful? Why are you surviving? Why are you okay? And you can say, because I have eaten the bread of life in this famine of death. And you should do the same too. What a gift that is. I want to close our time with a word from a guy named Martin Lloyd-Jones. And this is what he says. He says, trials and tribulations are very good for us, and that they help us to know ourselves better than we knew ourselves before. Through your suffering right now, God is refining you to be one of his tools that brings people to Christ to experience salvation and freedom from sin and death. Can you think of any better thing, any greater purpose? What a gift we have. What an opportunity we have. Oh, let's thank God for this. God, my Lord, my King, all-knowing, all-seeing, unchanging God. What a gift this has been to study the Bible. And it's right here in front of us. Everything is right here in front of us in this word. It's ours. You have revealed yourself, not just to Joseph, but you revealed yourself to us through the word. God, what a gift. You are the gift giver, the lover of our souls. Jesus, you are the Savior of the universe, and I love you. We love you, and we are on a mission, and with a smile and sometimes through tears, we accept our call as missionaries and ambassadors of the kingdom of God on earth. Have your way with us. Use us. Ah, we love you. You are amazing. You're the best. You're the best thing about us. And we are so thankful for that. And all God's people said, amen.
Hello, welcome to English Worship Service at JCCWC. Today is usually when we would gather together and do communion, although it is sad that we can't participate together. Let's just reflect with today's songs, God's only Son sacrificing his life for us.
Jesus Christ, side. Once again, I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. And now you are exalted to the highest place, King of the heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at this saving grace, and I'm full of praise once again.
In Psalm 119, 105, these exact words are reflected within the song. His word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. In this very dark time where it's like a lot of unhope and uncertainty, we can just hope on God and the light that he's shown for us through his son.
As long as you are near, please be
During this time, we again would usually take offering, but since we're not here together, you can do your giving online via the JCCWC website. Don't feel obligated if you don't have to at the moment, because it's a difficult time where not everyone can work at the moment. He was crucified, laid behind a stone, and lived to die rejected and alone. Let's just reflect on these and his love for us.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. To measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall.
My friends, as we close our time, I am again reminded of Paul and Silas in jail, singing in their suffering, not yet knowing that the reason they were brought there was to bring salvation to the jailer and his family. And I think that that's where a lot of us are right now. We're singing in our suffering, waiting to see what God would have for us. What a gift that is. I pray that he reveals it to you. He reveals it to us at a church, and he reveals it to all the Christians on earth in this time, because I think something big's coming. I don't know if it's true or not, but I'm hopeful. I'm hopeful in whatever it is that God has for us, something big, something small. I don't care. All I care about is that his will is done on earth, that it is in heaven. Amen. God bless you, my friends.